MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. In the United States, new reported cases are on the decline, with fully vaccinated at 39% and at least one dose of the vaccine at 49%. You can see that not only tests, but hospitalized patients and deaths are definitely in decline. We can see here a map of hotspots across the United States, as well as total cases, deaths, and cases per capita. In terms of the global outlook, cases are coming down, but there are still hotspots in particular areas, and we'll talk about those. One of those places is Brazil, where we did see a coming down off of the peak, but really has plateaued at this point and has not come down, and that's concerning. Although total daily deaths in Brazil have started to come down slightly. When we look at the share of people in Brazil that have gotten vaccinated, it is certainly less than that in the United States, but greater than the average in what we're seeing in the world. And they're at around 20%. Of course, the other hot spot in the world is India, which has recently seen a large spike with up to 400,000 people daily coming down with confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infections. And what we've seen is repeatedly every day, 4,000 people dying in India from COVID-19 and an overwhelming of the healthcare system. In terms of vaccinations, which ironically, remember that India is the largest producer of vaccines, and they are just above the world average in terms of vaccination rates, just north of 10% at this point. One of the things that's complicating issues in India is the outbreak of mucormycosis, otherwise known as black mold. This mold is just about everywhere. It's found in the soil. And some experts believe that the steroids, which reduces the immune system and also increases the blood sugar, is providing a recipe for the invasion of this fungus, which is typically seen in patients about 2 to 3 weeks after they recover from COVID-19. In this BBC article regarding this, they report here that there was 58 cases of the infection that happen usually 12 to 15 days after recovery from COVID-19. And that there have been 24 cases in the past 2 months, which was up from 6 cases a year in the past. But why has this happened in India but not other countries? There's an article in India Today that might shed some light onto potentially what is going on. They say here that the main reason is prolonged unhygienic oxygen delivery to patients combined with indiscriminate use of steroids. And part of the issue has to do with the lack of oxygen supplies in these countries where the healthcare system is overwhelmed. They say here that there's a vast difference between medical oxygen and industrial oxygen. Medical oxygen is a highly purified version that is more than 99.5% pure and is prepared through repeated steps of compression, filtration, and purification. The cylinders in which the liquid oxygen is stored, transported, are usually rigorously cleaned and disinfected. This oxygen requires humidification before being administered to patients, so it is passed through a container filled with sterile water. And that's the key word there, is sterile water. The water itself must be sterilized and changed frequently as per protocol. If the water is not sterile, it is potentially a source of the black fungus infection. The fungus infection is typically starting out in the sinuses and eating its way through into the bone, into the eyes, and potentially even the brain. So, of course, the recommendation would be to make sure that blood sugars are checked when the patients are on steroids, to make sure that we don't have out-of-control diabetes, to make sure that we're using medical oxygen, and to make sure that the humidification is through the use of sterile water. Based on the information that we currently have, these steps will help curb the increase in this mucormycosis or black fungus surge that we're seeing in India. Another country of concern is Japan, which, remember, is hosting the Olympics. Those games are scheduled to start in just under 2 months. But as you can see, they're in the midst of another surge, which at least equals any surge that they've had before. And the number of deaths every day at an all-time high. This is happening as it is being reported in Japan that the healthcare system is in dire warning of system collapse. There are reports of running out of beds and ventilators, and exhausted doctors again are warning of a, quote, system collapse, and advise against holding the Olympics this summer. This is particularly bad in the city of Osaka, which is the second largest city in Japan. And the reason why they believe this is happening now is because it's being fueled by the variant first discovered in the UK. And this seems to be hitting young people more than the first three waves in Japan. And the concern there is that the medical professionals that are working in Osaka are near exhaustion. The quote from the article states, some of them are racking up 100, 150, 200 hours of overtime, and that has been going on for a year now. When on duty, they sometimes go home at 1 or 2 in the morning and go to bed only to be awakened by a phone call at 3 or 4. And as you can see, part of the issue has been that Japan has remained below average in terms of world vaccination rates at only 4.85 currently. And you may ask, why is this happening in Japan? As you can see here, Japan started vaccinating in mid-February. The question is, why did they wait that long to do that? And as reported in this AP story, Japan began vaccinating healthcare workers in mid-February because of its decision prior to that to require additional vaccine clinical testing inside Japan, a decision many experts said was medically meaningless and only slowed down the inoculation process. Well, with the Olympics on the line in 2 months and an overwhelmed healthcare system in its western region, Japan is taking a definite turn in terms of its strategy. And while up to this point, the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine was the only one that was available in Japan, as of last week, they made approvals for Moderna and AstraZeneca for emergency use and will be ramping up the immunization process. So it'll be very interesting to watch how this unfolds. So this is a developing story, and we'll definitely keep an eye on this. Also in the news, the fact that Moderna will be applying for emergency use authorization for its vaccine in teenagers greater than 12 years of age. And we'll be doing a video coming up about vaccination in teens and reviewing the data. Another intervention that we have talked about extensively over the last year is convalescent plasma. And while there was some initial data that seemed to show promise, especially in high-dose antibodies given early in the course, it seems as though the final nail in the coffin, if you will, shows that convalescent plasma does not work, and it is being dropped from many protocols for the treatment of COVID-19. And this was a randomized controlled trial of 228 patients, where they were given fairly reasonable titers of convalescent plasma, and they looked at the clinical status of these patients and mortality, and there was no difference in mortality statistically significantly. It was 10.96 versus 11.43. And here you can see with the time on the x-axis and the probability of death on the y-axis, with red being the intervention, convalescent plasma, and blue being placebo, that there was no statistical significant difference between those two groups. And furthermore, here in terms of a probability of clinical improvement or hospital discharge, you can see here that there was no statistical significant difference here at day 30. Another one of the treatment possibilities that we talked about early in the course, especially in our update 46 and 47, was the potential use of hydrothermal therapy and whether or not a fever should be treated in COVID-19. And I'm happy to report that that theory has been codified scientifically in a paper that was published in Medical Hypotheses with experts out of Finland, where saunas are used quite often, and California, specifically at the Weimar Institute. And for those of you who are interested in the topic of hyperthermia and whether or not a fever should be treated and the biological and biochemical aspects of that, I highly recommend reading this article, which is a good summary of the research. The authors conclude that SARS-CoV-2 is susceptible to elevated body heat, and elevated body heat also enhances the immune system. We thus hypothesize that frequent treatments of heat followed by cold are the effective first-line approach in the prevention and treatment of mild coronavirus 2 infections. We recommend for all stages of COVID-19 that the most accessible method of hydrothermal therapy interventions be used, We urge that this hypothesis be implemented for the prevention and treatment of COVID-19 while we wait for results from studies designed to test the effectiveness of heat to improve the immune system function and treat COVID-19. Okay, thanks for joining us. You can help support us by visiting our website, medcram.com, subscribing to this YouTube channel, and turning on alerts by clicking on that bell icon, hitting the like button, leaving comments, and most importantly, sharing these videos with friends and family.